Well, good morning, everyone. It's good to see you. Thank you for coming and worshiping with us today. We have the privilege of beginning this service by baptizing three young Christian ladies. We've had a little malfunction in our baptistry this morning. We've got plenty of water, but it's not warm water. So it's going to be kind of like a creek in January. But they're young and strong, and they're ready for it. Yeah. Baptism is a symbol. It's an ordinance of the church. It's one of the two that Jesus commanded us to observe. One was the Lord's Supper. The other one is baptism. Baptism is an important symbol. When we go down underneath the water, it does two things. It reminds us of the death of Jesus, but also it reminds us of the death of our old nature. Because when we place our faith in Christ, we're a brand new creation. When we come up out of the water, that reminds us that Jesus defeated death and he arose from the grave. But it also reminds us that we are a new creation in Christ, and because of our faith in him, we too defeat death and we have eternity in heaven. Vicky, come on up. This is Vicky Milliken. Vicky has been a Christian for a long time, and she was baptized once before as a teenager, but she's come to a new place in her relationship with Jesus now, and she wants to mark that with this symbol of baptism. This is an entirely new season in life, a new season in her faith. Vicky, based upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, and your willingness to follow him in believer's baptism, I baptize you now in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. One of the things the observance of a baptism does is it reminds all of us of the time that we are baptized. It reminds all of us of our faith. Come on up, Brianna. And hopefully that helps to renew our faith. This is Rihanna Corson. She, too, has been a Christian since she was a teenager, but she's never been baptized. And so she comes today to follow the Lord's ordinance of baptism. Rihanna, based upon your faith in Jesus Christ and your willingness to follow him in believer's baptism, I baptize you now in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. I feel so bad. She was shivering. All right, Summer, come on up. This is Summer Corson, and Summer also is a Christian. She was baptized as a teenager, but she too has come to a new place in her relationship with the Lord, and she marks it today by being rebaptized. Go ahead and sit down, Summer. Summer, based upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ and your willingness to follow him in believer's baptism, I baptize you now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let's go ahead and join together in worship. Brooke, come on up and lead our song service.
Let's all stand together this morning. There's a crayon up here. We're going to start with, how can I keep from singing?
My name is Trevor. I get the privilege of reading and praying with you this morning. I'm going to read from 2 Timothy 1, 7 and 8. For God has not given us a spirit of fearfulness, but one of power, love, and sound judgment. So don't be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord or of me, his prisoner. Instead, share in the suffering of the gospel, relying on the power of God. Let us pray. Dear Lord, I want to thank you for this time we have together to gather in your house. Just thank you for what a privilege it is to be able to do that. I just want to thank you for giving us that privilege and just help us to grab something from the pastor today and take it away with us. I want to pray for all the people we have out right now, all the people out doing your will and serving you, Lord. Just pray that you put a hedge of protection around them. Just thank you for everything you do for us. We just want to be here in your glory. We want you to come and fill this place and let us worship you, Lord. These things we ask in your son's name. Amen.
You can go ahead and be seated this morning. Thank you for being here this morning. I'm Will, and I'm in charge of doing the announcements this morning. Pastor should never give me a microphone. Amen, brother. All right. Alan, that's enough from up there from you, big guy. A few things. Most of this is in your bulletin. There's an insert in there about the Lighthouse Christian Camp. There is plenty of ways to serve, driving the girls and the boys down there. It's a great way. It's a beautiful place, too, by the way, the Lighthouse Christian Camp, and where they get to go and do those things. So look at those dates. If you've got questions about that, you can contact Donna. Look at the insert, though. Bread of Life Missions Dinner is next Sunday, and as Pastor pointed out, that is Super Bowl Sunday. I mean, I don't watch NFL anyway. But anyway, the next Sunday at 5 p.m., and it looks like we are having pinto beans and cornbread. If you need help with that, you just need to see Miss Joyce there, and she will get you rolling in the right direction. Miss Joyce said, somebody bring some pinto beans. She needs pinto beans. Okay, so tell Miss Joyce you're doing that because she's a nice lady, and she might be do something mean to you. See, this is why Pastor don't give me the microphone very often, ain't it? But anyway, it's all right. High Hat, Kentucky, we do 125 boxes of food, of hams. Then we're going to take clothing up as well. That trip is on March 31st and the 1st. That's a great ministry as well. We do a lot of stuff here. If you ever ain't been here before and you're hearing all this for the first time, we're in Acts 1-8 church, and we do a lot of ministries all throughout the South and even into the foreign lands. And that brings me up to one more thing. We have a mission trip. YAC's coming up March 10th and the 11th. If you got questions about that, see Josh. Wave your hand, Josh, in case somebody don't know who you are. Do you wave his hand? All right. And as we talk about all these mission things that we're doing and things we're going on, our sister Regina Randolph, she is in Africa right now. She sent an email to Pastor telling about the situation there. The situation's pretty bad. So she's going to be setting up a getting the hospital ready for the people to come in, and she did ask us to pray for her. So before we go into welcoming everybody, I want to pray for Regina this morning. And pray along, too, as we pray for her this morning. Father, we just lift up our sister Regina to you right now, Lord, as she's there in Africa doing your work. God, we pray right now that you provide the things that she needs to accomplish the mission she needs to do before this group comes in, and they come in and they start serving the people there in Africa. God, I pray that you'll just take down barriers, that you'll take down any walls that are up, and just leave pathways open for Regina to complete this work. God, we also pray that you will just give her strength. Lord, that you will just watch over. Lord, that you will just give her the things that she needs every day to sustain. Lord, we also pray for our brother Mark, as his wife is there and she's serving. Lord, we lift him up to you. Give him encouragement to know the things that she is doing are for the kingdom of God. And Lord, that they're kingdom building. Lord, we just thank you for these, and we claim these things to you now in Jesus' name. Amen. Now we're going to, now you can go around and welcome everybody. Go around and say hi to somebody you don't know.
It's bothering me.
That's because he didn't want to be.
Oh.
It's her birthday month, Mom. Huh? It's her birthday weekend, Mom. Technically,
it's next Sunday. Oh, wow. I'm going to shake hands with that one lady before me.
It's next Sunday.
Next Tuesday.
Close enough.
Are you going to go dance?
Thank you.
All right, let's come on back. We'll continue our song service. On back to our seats, and we'll continue our song service.
All right. We will do anniversaries and birthdays next week. Ooh. So we're, this is really loud. All right, let's all stand together. We're going to sing Standing on the Promises. If you want to follow along in your hymnal, it's number 335. Standing on the Promises, this is our congregational hymn.
Promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let His praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. That cannot fail when the howling storms of doubt and fear assail. By the living word of God, I shall prevail, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, bound to Him eternally by love's strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises, I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
All right, for our offertory hymn, we're going to sing God Will Take Care of You. If you want to follow in your hymnal, it's number 64.
Be not dismayed, whate'er betide, God will take care of you. Beneath His wings of love abide, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you through days of toil when heart doth fail. God will take care of you. Dangers fierce your path assail.
pray.
Lord, we just thank you again for letting us be in your house today. Father, as we take up these tithes and offerings again, let them go to the furtherance of your kingdom.
Yes, Father.
God, we ask you to be with Brother Jim again today as he comes and brings the message. Lord, just hide behind the cross and let the words be coming and impactful to us today. We ask you all these things now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah, amen.
All right, for our last praise song before Pastor comes to bring the message, we're going to sing How Can It Be? If y'all will stand with us one last time.
Ashamed of what I've done, what I've become. These hands are dirty. I dare not lift them up to the Holy One. You plead my cause, you right my wrong. You break my chains, you overcome. You gave your life to give me mine. You say that I am free. How can it be? Afraid I've let you down. Inside I doubt that you still love me. But in your eyes there's only grace now. You plead my cause, you right my wrong. You break my chains, you overcome. You gave your life to give me mine. You say that I am free. How can it be? Yeah. How can it be? You break my chains, you overcome.
seated. And we'll go ahead and dismiss the children to Children's Church. Parents, as always, if you'd like to keep your children with you, you certainly may. Miss Linda has something special planned for them over there. I didn't hear the announcements, so I'm not really sure what Will covered. He probably told you about Regina. Did he tell you about Regina? Okay, all right. Did he tell you about the mission trip to Hi Hat? All right. Gosh, I should just sit down. Did he tell you about the baptism party? Okay. Right after the service, we're going to have a baptism party to celebrate the baptisms this morning. And so we've just got some cake and coffee and drinks and things back in the fellowship hall. And we want to invite you all to stay after the service and just have a piece of cake and get to know Vicky and Rihanna and Summer. And by the way, Summer and Dalton are engaged. They're going to have a wedding coming up here in a few months. So get to know everybody and just spend a few minutes before you take off this morning. All right, we're going to continue our study of 1 John, the letter of 1 John. We're going to be in chapter 5 this morning. And as we do that, as we continue that study, I'm going to use an example and a couple of illustrations that I've used before in a sermon before. I think it's probably a few years ago. I've used it also as a subject of a daily devotional theme for a month, and that was 5 or 6 years ago. So some of what I talk about this morning may be familiar to some of you. You may have heard these illustrations and examples before, but the reason I do that, the reason I've chosen to do that here this morning, is because those examples and illustrations do such a good job of emphasizing the point that John wants us to get here this morning in this section of 1 John chapter 5. And it comes from the example of Pastor David Jeremiah. And you know, I've long been a fan and admirer of David Jeremiah's ministry. I first became aware of him back in the early 1990s as I was retiring from my first career in the Navy and was beginning my second career as a pastor. And at that time, David was already well established as the senior pastor of Shadow Mountain Community Church, which is also in San Diego. It's actually in the town of El Cajon, eastern San Diego County. It was directly across the street from the seminary where I was going, Southern California Bible College and Seminary. David was a popular Christian author, conference speaker. As of today, he's written over 50 books. He's still the host of a very popular radio and television show called Turning Point. He continues to speak at Christian conferences around the country and around the world. And another thing I find admiring, or to admire, about David Jeremiah is that he's an overcomer. Over more than 50 years in ministry, David's had to deal with more than his share of professional and personal challenges, including cancer. He had stage 4 cancer, almost killed him more than 20 years ago. He pushed through it, and he survived. And today, he's in his 80s. I think he's like 81. And he still serves as the full-time senior pastor at Shadow Mountain. He continues to travel the world, speaking at Christian conferences. He still broadcasts his daily radio program, his weekly television program. He continues to write books. And he was one of the speakers at a conference I was at just a few years ago. And in that conference, as he was speaking from the stage, he explained one of the secrets, one of the keys to his longevity, to his continued effectiveness. And it's this statement that's up there on the screen right now. He says, "I just get up every day and I do whatever the next thing is. And I do it to the best of my ability. And then tomorrow, I get up and I do it again." And that's it. He just does whatever the next thing is. He does it to the best of his ability. And then he turns his attention to whatever the next thing is. And he just keeps doing it. He doesn't allow obstacles or discouragement or sickness or failure to stop him. He just keeps getting up every day, does whatever the next thing is to do, and then he does the next thing, and the next thing, and the next thing. David Jeremiah is an overcomer. And I think that he has a lot to teach the rest of us about being overcomers too. As a matter of fact, just a few years ago, he wrote a great book about that very subject. It's called Overcoming: 8 Ways to Live a Life of Unstoppable Strength, Unmovable Faith, and Unbelievable Power. It's a great book. I recommend it to you. The Apostle John, he was an overcomer too. In this final chapter of his letter, 1 John, he's going to tell us how we can become overcomers as well. Now, 1 John was specifically written to Christians, all right? And so the tone of the letter, it assumes that the readers are already familiar with the basic gospel message, and therefore there was no reason for John to repeat those basic truths. Instead, he was concerned with building the confidence of his readers so that we'll be better able to live well in a very difficult world, so that we'll be able to be overcomers. And that's what John wants us to get here through this passage. He wants us to know that it's through Christ that we can boldly face all the challenges of life and we can be overcomers. So let me point out to you this morning 3 keys that I believe we get from this passage about being an overcomer. And the first one is that faith is a key to overcoming. Chapter 5, we'll just look at verse 1 for the moment. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God. And everyone who loves the Father also loves the one born of him. We'll stop there for just a minute. Now, in these 4 verses that we're going to look at this morning, John emphasizes the believer's ability to overcome the world. And he begins with this important idea here in verse 1, that everyone who puts their faith in Jesus Christ is born of God. Born of God. In other words, born again. Obviously, you've been born once physically, but to be born of God is to be born again. This is what Jesus was explaining to Nicodemus in John chapter 3, when Jesus said to Nicodemus, "You must be born again." You've already been born physically, Nicodemus, but that's not good enough. You need to be born spiritually. It's what Paul was referring to in 2 Corinthians 5:17 regarding everybody who is in Christ. What did he say? He says that person is a new creation. It's not that you weren't a creation already. You were, but now you're a new creation. See, every human being is a creation of God. God formed you in the womb. He knit you together. He created you to be the unique individual that you are. So every person is a creation of God. But not every person is a child of God. Okay, this is what John meant when he wrote in the Gospel of John, chapter 1. It's going to come up on the screen for you. But to all who did receive him, to all who did place their faith in Christ, he gave them the right to be children of God. To those who believe in his name, who were born not of natural descent or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. Okay, that right there is what both Jesus in John 3:3 and Paul in 2 Corinthians 5:17, that's what they meant. And it's what John is referring to here in 1 John chapter 5. See, this is a starting place for a relationship with God. And this is the key to becoming an overcomer through the power of Christ at work in you and through you. It takes faith in Christ. But what is that? I mean, what does it mean to have faith? And what does that look like in the life of a Christ follower who is an overcomer? Hebrews chapter 11 is commonly referred to as the Faith Hall of Fame. And in Hebrews 1, it says, "Now faith is the reality of what is hoped for, the proof of what is not seen." You know, very often when we're in the process of overcoming anything in life, we can get discouraged. And we can wonder if our efforts are really accomplishing anything. You know, and just to name some examples of typical life issues, you know, maybe you're struggling to hold your marriage together, and it's just going on and on and on. Maybe you have to deal every day with difficult coworkers. Maybe you're trying to pay your way out from under a mountain of debt. Maybe it's all that weight you've been trying to lose. Maybe it's any other challenge that requires discipline and perseverance over an extended period of time, and the effort can seem endless. How do we believe that it's true to begin with, or that it's possible to begin with? And then how do we stay hopeful? How do we keep going? Well, we do it by faith. We believe it can be done, and so we begin, and then we just keep going. We don't stop. This is true in all the challenges that we face as Christians. Hebrews chapter 11, like I said, it's often referred to as the Faith Hall of Fame. And in this chapter, the writer recounts the stories of numerous biblical heroes who simply resolved to do the right thing, to do it for as long as it took, and to just trust God for the outcome. Folks, that's faith. That's overcoming through faith. And so we read here that by faith, Abel offered to God a better sacrifice than Cain did. He says, by faith, Enoch was taken away. By faith, Noah built an ark. By faith, Abraham set out for the place that God called him to go. By faith, Sarah had a child. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau concerning things that were yet to come far in the future. By faith, Moses did not fear the Pharaoh, but he went and he faced him. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down. By faith, Rahab the prostitute welcomed the spies, even though it was dangerous to do so. By faith, countless others bravely faced persecution and even death. 21 times in this single chapter in Hebrews 11, a biblical hero is commended for extraordinary faith when faced with difficult circumstances. And in every case, the point being made is that the person or the people involved just made up their minds that they were going to lean into the challenge, persevere, push through it, and trust God for the results. That's faith. And what each of these great saints here in Hebrews chapter 11 knew was the truth that is expressed right there in Hebrews 11:6. Now, without faith, it's impossible to please God. The lesson here for us in all of this, and specifically in 1 John chapter 5, is that the way we overcome anything in life is we have faith, we do the right thing, and we just keep doing it. We trust God for the outcome. Do what you know to be right. Don't quit. Trust God. That is faith. And faith is a key element in being an overcomer. Here's another one. Fellowship is essential to overcoming. Fellowship with your brothers and sisters in Christ, with a good church family. This is an essential element in being an overcomer. Back to verse 1. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the Father also loves the one born of the Father. What John's doing here is he's reiterating the point that he has made several times already in this letter, and he hit it pretty hard in the last part of chapter 4, which we looked at in last week's sermon, that if you truly do love God, then you will truly love those who are born of God. In other words, other Christians. See, it's like we talked about in last week's sermon. If you love God, you will love God's people. And if you don't love God's people, then you don't love God. John himself said this in 1 John 4:20. He says, if anyone says, I love God, and yet hates his brother or sister, he's a liar. For the person who does not love his brother or sister who he has seen cannot love God who he has not seen. We need each other. We need to be in good fellowship with each other. We need to be coming around each other, supporting each other, encouraging each other, helping each other to stand strong in the most difficult times of life. That's one of the keys to being an overcomer, having the support and the encouragement and strength we can draw from our brothers and sisters in Christ. You know, for most of my adult life, I was a jogger. And back when my knees could take it, three or four times a week, I'd go out and I'd jog 4 or 5 miles as part of my regular workout routine. And occasionally, sometimes, I'd participate in longer races. And the longer race I ever ran, the longest race I ever ran, was a half marathon. It was 13.1 miles. And the race was called the Hospital Hill Run. And the reason it was is because it ended at a hospital that sat on top of a very steep hill. And I often thought, and I especially thought it as I was running the race, that it was kind of sick humor on the part of the race planners to plan a long run up a steep hill that ends after 13 miles at the front door of a hospital. It's probably very appropriate. But, you know, one good thing that they did is they arranged for crowds of enthusiastic onlookers to line both sides of the street all the way up the long hill that brought you right to the finish line. So as we exhausted racers struggled up this steep incline, there was crowds of people all along the street cheering us on, shouting words of encouragement. You know, I've always loved that passage in Hebrews chapter 12. The writer writes, "Therefore, since we also have such a large crowd of witnesses surrounding us, let us lay aside every hindrance and the sin that so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that lies before us, keeping our eyes on Jesus, the source and the perfecter of our faith." That large crowd of witnesses, sometimes Christians read that and they think, you know, well, this is in the spiritual realm. You know, this is, you know, all the people who have gone before us, they can still see me today and they're my witnesses, they're watching. I don't know if that's true or not. I think the witnesses that are being referred to here are you all. I think when I was running up that hospital hill and all those onlookers were cheering me on and they were encouraging me, and as much as I was struggling, I did not want to stop. I did not want to give in to the burning in my legs or the nausea in my gut in front of that crowd. And that encouraged me to just keep going, to just keep pushing, to keep my eyes on the finish line and just keep going until I got there. That's what's being described in Hebrews chapter 12. You all are the witnesses, and we're encouraging each other. And what's being pictured here is that we are in a race, and it's a long race, and it lasts a lifetime. But God has surrounded us with brothers and sisters in Christ to cheer us on and to keep us going. And this right here is one of the keys to overcoming in life. Instead of focusing on the obstacles we're facing, we focus on Jesus instead, who's there at the finish line, and he's waving us on, encouraging us to keep going. And in the meantime, we've got this crowd of witnesses around us, and they're encouraging us, and they're saying, don't give up, just keep going. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Folks, this is an important point. And when it comes to being an overcomer through the power of Christ, you need to have good relationships with other Christians. You need to have brothers and sisters in Christ. You need a band of brothers, a band of sisters. You need a church family who will stand with you. This is what Solomon was talking about in Ecclesiastes chapter 4 when he wrote this. He says, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their efforts. For if either falls, his companion can lift him up. But pity the one who falls without another to lift him up. And also if two lie down together, they can keep warm. But how can one person alone keep warm? And if someone overpowers one person, two can resist him. A cord of three strands is not easily broken. He's talking about our need for each other. He's talking about this strong fellowship that we have. He reiterated that point. He made the same point in Proverbs 27:17 when he says, iron sharpens iron and one person sharpens another. Okay, this is what we do for each other. We keep each other strong. We keep each other sharp. And that's why God has gathered us together in these little church families so that we can do that for each other. Fellowship is a key to overcoming. We need each other. And then there's one more that's in this passage. Obedience is a key to overcoming. Verse 2. This is how we know that we love God's children, when we love God and obey His commands. For this is what love for God is, to keep His commands. And His commands are not a burden, because everyone who has been born of God conquers the world. This is the victory that has conquered the world, our faith. All right, so how do we develop obedience? How do we train ourselves to be obedient? Well, the first thing is we need to know what it is we're expected to obey. I mean, we know who we're expected to obey. That's God, right? But what are we expected to obey? What is it He's expecting us to be obedient to? And the answer, of course, is His Word. It's the Bible. We need to know the Bible, and then we need to live according to biblical principles. This right here is a key to overcoming the challenges of life through faith in Christ. We know what it is God expects of us because He has told us in His written Word. We know these biblical principles. We apply them to our lives. That guides us in how we live this life. In Psalm 119, verses 1 and 2, we read this: "How happy are those whose way is blameless, who walk according to the Lord's instruction. Happy are those who keep His decrees and seek Him with all their hearts." Folks, I want to tell you here this morning that obeying God is not mysterious. Obeying God is not some kind of puzzle we need to figure out, some kind of spiritual mystery we have to unravel. God has told us what to do, and He's told us what not to do. And for all those cases that are in between, that it's not crystal clear what to do or what not to do, He's given us Proverbs 5, 3 and 6, or Proverbs 3, 5 and 6. "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight." You walk into those situations with a heart that is absolutely resolved to obey God. That's your only desire. You want to be in the center of His will. If that's your approach, you can trust God to guide you. He's more vested in your obedience than you are. He wants your success more than you want it. He wants your obedience even more than you want to obey. If your heart is right, He'll guide you. The Apostle Paul, in the words inspired by the Holy Spirit, he says the words of the Bible are inspired by the Holy Spirit. In 2 Timothy 3:16, he assured us that all Scripture is inspired by God. You know what that means? That means that there is spiritual power in the printed words of the Bible. These are the inspired words of God speaking to your mind and to your heart. There's a force in these words that goes far beyond the power of the words themselves. This is how God uses the words of the Bible to have such a powerful and transforming impact on us. The words come alive in our mind and our heart, giving them significance, giving them power far beyond anything they would otherwise have. And it's because the Holy Spirit of God inhabits these words. The Holy Spirit of God empowers these words, and He infuses them. He drives them deep into your mind and heart. And so these words come alive for you far beyond what they would normally do, just being words. That's what the writer of Psalm 119 was referring to all throughout that long psalm. But in verse 105, he says, "Your word is a lamp for my feet. It's a light for my path." Psalm 119 is essentially 176 verses proclaiming the wonder, the power, the glory of the Bible, and how much God's guidance is right there for us to take us through each day. That's why it's so important for Christians to read their Bible, to know their Bible well every single day. You know, prayer is important, but reading the Bible is even more important. Did you know that? As important as prayer is, it's more important to read the Bible. Henry Blackaby, the author of Experiencing God, once wrote this. He explained it this way. He says, "If I have to choose between praying or reading the Bible, I will always choose to read the Bible because it's more important for me to hear from God than for God to hear from me. That's an important statement. It is more important for you to hear from God than it is for God to hear from you. There's an old saying in Christian circles that goes, a Bible that's falling apart is usually owned by somebody who isn't. It's very true. Regular daily reading of the Word of God goes a long, long way towards keeping us settled and calm and clear-headed and wise and peaceful and joyful and on the right track in life. Okay, this is a key understanding, and it's crucial to living the life of an overcomer through the power of Christ in your life. Determine you're going to do the right thing, be obedient, and then trust God for the outcome. Great advice, easier said than done. Sometimes it's just hard to do. Especially to do it for a long, long time. You know, sometimes it's just difficult to be an overcomer because seldom do we overcome anything quickly. You know, usually it takes a long time. Sometimes it takes a lifetime. Some of you are familiar with the great story that was the theme of the movie Mr. Holland's Opus. The term opus is usually used to, you know, it's in music to identify a large body of work by a single artist. But a magnum opus refers to a person's crowning achievement. Or sometimes it refers to the totality of that person's work and achievements. It's usually used to refer to some kind of artistic work, but it can also be used to describe achievements in any field of life. And sometimes, even the sum total of a person's life in general. And in that vein, when it's all said and done, the sum total of your life can be considered to be your magnum opus. So anyway, back to the movie. Mr. Holland, who's played by Richard Dreyfuss, he's a music teacher with dreams of being a great composer, writing a musical score that's going to be performed by a full orchestra. But in the meantime, he has to pay the bills. In the meantime, he needs to have a job, be able to support his family. So he takes a job as a high school music teacher during the day, and then composing music, his masterpiece, his opus, at night. And as the years unfold, he gets married, he buys a home, he has children. And slowly, the years turn into decades. And one day, Mr. Holland realizes he's old, and he's being forced into retirement. And although he's made some progress on his opus, this masterwork, it was never published, it was never performed. So anyway, on his last day of school, last day on the job, he's cleaned out his office, he's trudging down the hallway towards the door, his shoulders are slumped, he's wondering where his life went. He hears a commotion over in the gym. And just out of curiosity, he goes and he opens the door and he looks in. And he finds that the place is packed with people, and they're all waiting for him. And he's stunned to see old friends, long-lost relatives, close family members, fellow teachers from the past and current. And on the stage, there's four decades of his music students, and all of them with their instruments. And with tears in his eyes, he listens as the orchestra, made up of his own students, plays his opus. And in that moment, Mr. Holland realized that his true masterpiece was not the music. It was the lives he had touched. And his magnum opus was the people he had blessed and whose lives he had helped to shape over four decades of faithful service as a teacher. Folks, there's a lot we can take from that story. The truth is that you are having a positive impact on more people than you realize, and in more ways than you realize. And someday, when it's all said and done, and your life is drawing to a close, you're going to discover that your magnum opus consists of the people you have blessed and those who have been inspired by you. And so my word to you here this morning is hang in there. Just keep going. God has you right where he wants you. And even if you don't realize it, he is using you right now to bless and inspire other people. And the little things that you do every single day in your life matter. So just do your best. Know that you are making a difference. And just keep being you. Keep being an overcomer. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we just come and we worship you. And we thank you that it is because of what you did for us on the cross that we can have victory in life. We can have victory over all these challenges. We thank you that by the power of your Holy Spirit living in our hearts, you have enabled us to have victory, to be overcomers. And so as we think about our lives and the good things that you've done through them, we give you all the credit for it. We thank you for saving us, guaranteeing us of eternity in heaven, but we thank you for empowering us to live life well now. We give you all the praise for it in your great name. Amen. We're going to end this morning with the time of invitation. We started with the baptism, a baptism that signifies faith in Christ. And you know, maybe those people who are in that baptistry this morning, maybe they know and have experienced something that's new to you. Maybe you're here today in this sanctuary, or maybe you're online right now, and you've never had a moment in time where you've made an intentional decision to place your faith in Christ. Okay, that is the starting place. That is where it all begins. It takes that moment in time where you've decided, I need Jesus. I want Jesus. And then you pray and you open your heart and invite him into your life. He'll forgive all your sins, but then he'll put his Holy Spirit in your heart, begin working in your life, begin transforming you into the person that God wants you to be. It all starts with the moment in time, with a decision. And if you've never done that, I encourage you to do it today. Come forward, tell me that. Well, I'm going to be standing up in front in a moment as we're singing a song. Just tell me that and I'll pray with you and help you to start your new life as a Christian. For those of you online, if you're placing your faith in Christ this morning, just send me a note there on the website. Let me know that and I'll get in touch with you. If you don't have a church home, but you'd like to be a member of Oak Hill Baptist, we'd love to have you. You come forward and tell me that. I'll tell you how you could join our church. And maybe you just have something you need prayer for. We all do. Every day, every person in this church has something going on in their lives that they wish was not there. Maybe that's you this morning and you just need something to, you just need to come forward and kneel at the altar and pray. Maybe go to the cross. Put a stone at the foot of the cross as a symbol of something you're releasing to the Lord. For any of those reasons, why don't you come forward now as we're singing? Let's stand together.